David Friedman is going to come up and talk to us about the anatomy of the ultra wealthy and trends shaping the global wealth landscape. And David is the co-founder of Wealth-X. Some of you may be familiar with that report through UBS, and co-founder of his new venture, LifeChain. He started his career at Oxford Analytics, the world's leading geopolitical and declassified intelligence firm, and recently joined their international advisory board. He's a serial entrepreneur, again, with his most recent venture, Wealth-X, focused on proprietary wealth data and intelligence, and he left that back in the fall and is now in the process of starting his new venture, LifeChain. And LifeChain, blockchain, deals with the blockchain and how family offices may utilize that. Also, his other enterprise, Vesta, it's a multifamily office leveraging LifeChain's unique platform. There's a company called Premex that, again, that deals with digital luxury advertising across ecosystem platforms, and Wealth Quotient, a sales and strategy training and engagement firm for the ultra affluent. And you know, from that standpoint, this man, when I first heard him speak, I don't know what he's saying all the time, but it's pretty impressive. His pay grade's way beyond. And he also grew up in Charlotte, North Carolina, so he understands our part of the world. So with that, I'm gonna ask David Friedman to come up here and start our day for us. David, thank you.
Am I good? Can you hear me? Am I up? It's good? You guys got it? Okay. I was the one kid in high school that when in the plays, the director of the play would have people come up and say, more, stand at the back of the room, and I would get up and he'd say, tone it down. So I always had like a super loud. Anyway, so good morning. Good to see you guys. You know, I couldn't resist the fact that there's so much political turmoil going on right now in the world, and it's so controversial and everything. Everyone's up in arms, and the public discourse has become strident. And so having this public stage, I have to make a comment, which is definitively, we have decided that real barbecue is pulled pork, not brisket. Because I'm from North Carolina. Yeah. And a good pulled pork will always be brisket, right? So I know, hopefully you didn't think I was going somewhere else with that, right? That's the most political comment. So let me get the clicker. All right. I always like to kind of start out with some things to get us thinking about wealth. So I was thinking, by the way, I have a theology degree from Yale in the role of religious arguments in public debate. I did my thesis in the Divinity School before I moved to Silicon Valley and did strategy consulting, which was the next logical step after Divinity School. So I was thinking, in your world, in the world of families, I thought, what's the most complicated, if you look back in history, what's the most complicated wealth design, you know, that you could have in history, right? And I thought, okay, well, it has to do obviously with wives and children and, you know, offshore private placement insurance policies. And I'm teasing. But so I thought, you know, wouldn't it be interesting if you had King Solomon as a client? Because King Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. You guys can laugh. I'm not trying to shock you or anything. This is supposed to be funny, not serious. Some people out there are like, oh, I can't. I'm quitting my job if I have to do that. I mean, but imagine the complexity, because you guys do with Gen 5, 6, 7. But imagine Gen 1 with 700 wives, right? It's funny. I was with my son the other day. We were talking about this because I was kind of sharing what I was doing. He's like, didn't Solomon make a bad mistake, Dad? I'm like, yeah, he married 700 wives. That was the issue. Anyway, so I thought that would have been interesting if you think about it. It also, there are different reports, but Solomon was the wealthiest person in history. I think his equivalent net worth was like $4 trillion, if you translate it in today's. So managing those assets would have been good. I think 1%. So about, I think, and I know you can't see this, but I'm going to read it to you. This was an ATM stamp found by a reporter in East Hampton. You guys know the Hamptons, kind of where all the New Yorkers go to play. So this was an ATM stamp found by a reporter in East Hampton, and it was published in the newspaper. And the reason it was published in the newspaper is, it's hard to see here, but I'll read it for you. This person at 10:14 at night in East Hampton got out $400. There was an ATM fee of $275, so the total withdrawal amount was $402.75. But the remaining balance was $99,864,731.94 in a savings account or checking account, right? So we used to say Capital One is making a lot of money off this, but Capital One just did the ATM transaction. So, but I like to ask the question, because we, wealth in a general sense, and I have a lot of data I'm going to talk about, but I like to ask the question that brings that out of the abstraction into the real, right? Who has $99 million in a checking account? What are the options, right? Come on, what are the options? Give me a guess. Dan, what do you think? No. Oh, that's a good way to think about it. What to do with? No. Who has night? Who is this person? Everybody was, by the way, trying to figure that out. But who is this person? Who has $99 million in a checking account? I'll get you going. All right, mate.
Russian oligarch.
There you go. That's my favorite one. Right. He's rolling around in East Hampton. Maybe he's going to buy a yacht. Maybe a new Porsche 918, which is $1.6 million. Although he still has a lot left over. So maybe it's a Russian oligarch, because they're rolling around in East Hampton, not as much as more they used to be. Maybe it's an entrepreneur. Maybe he just had his liquidity event. Maybe the money got wired and is sitting in account, and Goldman Sachs hasn't gotten to him yet, right? Or you guys haven't gotten to him yet, right? And so he's just sitting there, he's trying to figure out, and his friends have told him, he's an entrepreneur, by the way, so his friends have said, just put it in an ETF. So he's getting ready to put it in a Vanguard ETF. I'm joking. But a lot of my entrepreneurial friends, that's how they think, right? So maybe it's that, or what else? Probably the last thing, but probably most people think this is it. It was a hedge fund manager who just got his weekly bonus. I mean, he's like, you know. But my point in this is there's a story behind that number. And you guys, most of the people in this room with the families, or if you are a family or you've dealt with the families, this number has a whole narrative around it, a story. It's how they got it, and the way they got it shapes everything about who they are today and how they got there, what they sacrificed. Did they spend time with their children, or did they build their business? And so this number is a number, but it's a narrative. It's a story, right? I just thought this was hilarious. I couldn't resist showing it. This was the most expensive car crash in history. So this was in Monaco. This was several cars. They kind of all came together at once. I think it was over $1 million in kind of car crash. But the most hilarious thing is, if you look at this, you guys can see that basically the way that they've crashed, the doors are all hemmed in. So note, and by the way, everyone's too dignified to actually crawl out of the car. So tourists started going around the cars and taking pictures. So these poor people are sitting baked in the sun with tourists taking pictures of them on a hot afternoon. But I thought it was hilarious. And this is in Monaco, right? So only in Monaco are you going to have a car crash like this, right? Or maybe in Houston, right? I don't know. I know we're focused on U.S. wealth mostly, but I like to give people kind of a picture of what's going on globally. And I always like to say that some municipalities in different places in the world have larger, much larger budgets than other places. So in Dubai, the police cars are Ferrari and a Lamborghini, right? And I always joke that they need the Ferrari because Sheikh Mohammed has the Ferrari, has 1,200 horsepower, right? So of course he's never going to pull him over. Maybe he'll pull up and say hello, right? But anyway. So I was speaking in Dubai at a luxury conference, and there's a new, relatively new, I should say, it's about 3 or 4 years old. There's a new sports car company called Lycan Hypersport, which is an amazing car. It's one of the most expensive in the world. And I was on a panel with a guy who's an entrepreneur. He's my age. He started this company. And who's seen Fast and Furious 7? Come on, be honest. Okay, there you go. Thank you. It's the car that comes out of the, you know, the tower, right? It's called a Lycan Hypersport. And I was talking to him. He said, listen, I just got, it's so funny you're talking about this, because I just got a call from the Dubai Police Department. They said they needed a new car. which is, so they said, can we have a Lycan Hypersport? About, you know, it's 1. I think it's $1.5 to $2 million car. And he said, yeah, and then 30 to 40 minutes later, I got a call, and if you guys know Dubai or Abu Dhabi, Dubai has no money, right? It gets it all from Abu Dhabi. I got a call 30 minutes later, and Abu Dhabi said, no, we'll take that car for our police car. So now the Abu Dhabi has the Lycan Hypersport for its police car, right? It's a beautiful car though, right? I asked him, I said, listen, can I just rent one of those for the Hamptons? I'll be the only guy in Sag Harbor driving around, right? But, because there's every other car. But anyway, so wealth, as we know, is becoming more global, and there's amazing things happening in different parts of the world that would, I think, shock you, but also enlighten you, right? So, background. So just quickly about me, why should you listen to me? I started a company 6 or 7 years ago called Wealth-X with my co-founder, he was at Forbes. We built a proprietary data set on the world's wealthiest people. It didn't exist before then because most of the world's wealth of the ultra affluent is privately held. So income and housing values, which is what traditionally people use, didn't work. So we built this asset over the last 6 or 7 years. And because it was really the first time and the only time that someone had created that data, we became the experts. So by default. And so we, you know, I mean, I used to be, when I was with WealthX in the news all the time, I was kind of the go-to person on wealth, right, on the ultra affluent. Fortunately, the company did well, and my co-founder and I sold a majority of it to a private equity fund in New York, who now owns it. I was complaining about something the other day. My mother reminded me it's not my company anymore, rightfully so. But, and then now I've moved on to areas across a portfolio of areas where I see there's disruption, where wealth and data is going to disrupt all kinds of different industries. So that's my background, quickly. So what about some of the key trends? So I think one of the most valuable things I can do for you guys is to, I was fortunate. I sat on a perch where I talked with the CEOs of the top luxury brands, right? All the private banks and multifamily offices. And all the nonprofits. So I could see across all this landscape at the things that were shaping their donors, their clients, what they were buying, what they wanted. And so, because most of those worlds are kind of siloed, right? If you think about it, and they don't interact that much. They do sometimes around events and whatnot. So I wanted to run through what I see is happening in the world that's shaping the wealth landscape. When I say shaping the wealth landscape, what I mean is shaping the world around the ultra affluent. And so I often say, these things may have nothing to do with you personally, but they do have to do with your clients, right? And so the first is obviously the biggest, right? It's the income inequality, which has been, it's been a major topic around everything. So this is the chairman of Richemont, one of the largest conglomerates of luxury brands. He himself is a billionaire, right? He came out, it was actually in Monaco, at a luxury conference. He came out and the first thing he said to the audience was, my biggest fear over the next decade is that robots will replace the middle class. Which if you're at a luxury conference, it's one of the most odd things you could say. But more and more I've come to realize it was a fascinating and brilliant observation. And why is that? Well, his view was, he basically, and this, by the way, CNN called me, I was in London at the time, they said, hey, can you come in? We want to respond to this. And we were going to show the clip, but unfortunately the video wasn't working. But the bottom line was, you know, if his concern was that if the middle class gets replaced by robots, who's going to wear, you know, his clients are not going to want to wear a Cartier watch. Because if you have no middle class, you just have the haves and the have-nots. So his concern from a revenue perspective was that no one's going to. Now, I wish I had said it when I was on the show, but it's always afterwards you come up with the great zingers, but I wanted to say, don't worry, robots with artificial intelligence will learn to wear Cartier watches. they'll end up buying them as well. But why is this important to your clients? Well, the reality is if your client is in the trucking business or manufacturing business or anything that has labor attached to it, over the next decade, his workforce is going to get replaced, most likely, and optimized through robots. What does that do for his business? Well, it optimizes it from a revenue and profit standpoint, but from a perception standpoint, it makes it different. So while you think he may have more money because his business is getting streamlined, psychologically what will happen is a different thing, right? And I know many of you are not thinking this way, and this is far out, although it's not that far out, guys. I mean, with self-driving cars now coming. And I don't know if you guys saw, Dubai now has self-driving hovers, taxis. So they pick you up and they take you. But this is, if you want to be thinking ahead for your clients, then you should be reading up on this. What another big trend that I'm seeing, and I know because of my position, I get calls every day from someone saying, hey, we built a new online digital vault for the ultra wealthy. We're going to make it the most secure place where they can all go and have community. So I hear that 1,000 times a day. And that's great, and there's lots of people doing it. But the trend that I've seen is not digital. It's back to the physical clubs. So this is Michael Birch. He sold Bebo in London for about $700 million. Michael started a club in San Francisco called The Battery. Who's heard of The Battery? Anyone? Okay. The Battery, yeah, obviously, Dan, you've heard of The Battery, right? Yeah. The Battery, and he's a good friend. The Battery, he started 3 years ago. He said, hey, there's no cool, really cool, well-designed private members club in San Francisco. So he started it. And now, you know who hangs out there? If you walk in the lobby, everybody. Every tech billionaire, right? They're all there. And the waiting list is 10 years long, and guess who's on the waiting list? Every hedge fund manager, right? Right. But if you talk to Michael, he said, I'm curating a community. I'm putting people together. And his primary driver, and I don't know if David, if you guys have talked to him, but his primary driver is philanthropy. So it's called Battery Powered. But he wanted to be able to convene a group of people to quickly act in philanthropic situations. And so he built The Battery, and The Battery is a great club. There's another club in New York that just launched last year by the publisher of Worth Magazine, Patrick Williams, who's a good friend, called Thursday Morning, where they get together. They don't have a fixed space, but they get together. This most recent project, which actually I'm consulting on for a gentleman in Southampton, is called The Lodge. The Lodge is the WeWork for the ultra wealthy. It's a place where you can go and be among peers and do co-working space, which we were talking about earlier. It's a massive trend, right? Because WeWork, if you've been there, is fantastic, except it's a little wired towards frat boys with, they have beer in the morning and all the good stuff, right? So, anyway. But they're killing it, right, for the entrepreneurs. So I think this whole notion of place, and I think fundamentally what's underneath this is a desire for community. I believe that this core impulse for community is driving this, and this growth towards private membership clubs. And I think we're going to see a whole lot more of these. One of the other big things that's happening, when I would meet with the CEOs of luxury brands, they would say to me, well, where do you think we should go? Because what's happened in China, the Chinese consumers pulled back significantly, right? There was the anti-corruption purge. Macau revenues kind of, for the first time in history, went down, which was unbelievable. So when I would talk to luxury brands, they would say, the new emerging market is Chicago. It's the Midwest. Because there's a lot of wealth, I mean, you guys know LVMH is, do you know where Laura Piana just set up its new store? Do you guys know Laura Piana? It's a high-end cashmere, like super high-end cashmere, like very, very expensive. You know where their new store is? Here, in Houston. Which you guys will say, well, we always knew that. Everybody's just figuring it out, right? There you go. One of the other big pivots in the luxury brands, and especially this was the Camper Nicholson report that they did with Wealth-X, but one of the fascinating observations that came out of the data and the analysis was, if you traditionally look at yacht sales and the marketing in a video, you see a family being served by a swarm of different people, serving them dinner, serving them all kinds of things. And what came out of their study and really kind of crawling around in the mind of the yacht owner was, the yacht itself is not the thing, it's the journey. And it's the process of having a luxury experience. So they've now, if you look at their marketing materials, there's no people serving. It's a family having dinner, laughing with the best view. platform for luxury experiences, right? And that, by the way, is the future of engaging this audience. They told at the PR, at the press conference, they told a story about a guy who had built, I think it was like a $300 million yacht. He'd spent 5 years as part of the design process and building and whatnot. At the launch, in the yard, you know, they had a big party, and I don't know if he did the ceremonial like with the bottle of champagne, but after he had announced it, toasted, and said thank you, he said, and I have an announcement. Today, we start the next one. Why is that? Because it was about the journey. It was about the experience. So you guys have probably heard this notion of social graph, right? Facebook uses the term, and they call it the social graph. The interconnections of all you are and who you are. It's why Facebook is so powerful, right? Amex has been calling what they have in terms of mapping your spending, the spending graph, right? And LinkedIn calls it, I've heard it called the professional graph. They also call it the economic graph. I think professional graph is a better designation, but it is what it is. But the thing that WealthX built, which I called it, is the wealth graph. It is the subterranean relationships and maps of every ultra high net worth wealthy individual in the world. This was a study we did for ABC where we basically looked at the social graph of all the ultra wealthy, and we said, who has the most valuable relationship? If you added up all the relationships, who has the most valuable? Not surprising, obviously, Bill Clinton came in on the top. So. But one of the other big trends I'm seeing, when you have wealth, there's an emergence of risk, right? And in this case, philanthropy, philanthropic giving, and risk, right? And we know some of the scrutiny that their foundation has come under. And as you get out of the U.S., once you get out of the U.S., those two graphs, I call it the risk graph and the wealth graph, those things start to become almost inextricable, right? Do you guys know who the guy is on the left? It's Putin's judo partner since they've been 6 years old, right? If you don't know him, you should. By the way, though, if you run his name through AML, he's definitely not going to be able to open an account, right? So, but he's probably one of the most powerful men in the world. But let me tell you, it's fascinating. So they, and this is interesting, so Putin shut down every history school textbook publishing company in Russia except one. He then took it over. He renamed Enlightenment Publishing. They reincorporated it in Cyprus. And his buddy, Rottenberg, who's his judo partner since they've been six, is now the chairman of the board. Now if you don't see what's going to happen, he's going to rewrite their history for them. Right? What I thought was interesting, though, and what I was trying to emphasize here was, guess who's distributing the power books for Enlightenment Publishing? Microsoft is, right? But all these things are, and you guys know, you may or may not be aware of casinos in Macau, US casinos in Macau have to do the same due diligence on Chinese that you have to do on Americans. They have to do AML and KYC, or obviously for money laundering. So the world is gonna get more and more complex around wealth and risk. You guys probably saw this, you may or may not have seen this, In one area in particular where these things are converging is luxury real estate. So, you know, this is great. It basically said New York luxury real estate's the new Swiss bank account, right? And I was speaking at the Douglas Elliman, Knight Frank. They had an event to launch the Wealth Report last year. And Robert Frank from CNBC was the host. He's a good friend of mine. He's the wealth guy on CNBC. And he, one of the things I told, I stood up in that room, there was probably 400 of the top brokers, real estate brokers in New York, and I said, everything I'm talking about risk, guess what, guys, it's coming your way. It's gonna hit you. Because today there's no AML KYC for luxury real estate in New York. Think about it, a $60 million penthouse? $20 million penthouse, right? So he sent me an email late last year. A lot of the scrutiny was prompted by this article by the New York Times did on who's in this building, right? Who's in that building? And then the Department of Justice announced, if you are a foreign buyer and you buy a luxury real estate asset in New York above $3 million,
you will disclose who you are. You will not wrap it in a offshore account, LLC, LLP, whatever it is. And they have 20 FBI agents combing through ownership documents for New York. In Miami, it's 1 million. And if you think they're gonna stop there, they're not. I mean, so luxury and risk. Now, add on top of that, EB-5. Who here knows what EB-5 is, right? EB-5 is the investment program that allows you to invest $500,000 and get a green card in the US. In particular, if you're a real estate developer in the US, you most likely have EB-5 funding your investment, because EB-5 is like free money. What I'm telling and what I've been telling people, there is no due diligence done on this money for EB-5 programs. Now, the US government doesn't care about that, and that's okay, because it's free money and it's doing good things. But there'll be a headline, if not this year, the next year, around the EB-5 and the diligence, because 90% of this money is from the Chinese, right? Individuals. And the US government doesn't have the resources to do due diligence on each one of them. I was surprised that it didn't come up in the campaign, but a lot of Trump stuff is EB-5 funded, which is Chinese. These are Chinese immigrants funding his real estate developments for a green card, right? So, fascinating. Which raises another thing. So EB-5 program is what we call economic citizenship programs. One of the most fascinating philosophical questions facing people today is where are you from? Because there is a new class of global citizens that have 5 passports. And for $1 million in Malta, you can get an EU passport, because Malta is part of the EU. But think about that. That's tremendous if you're Russian. And so this whole new notion of economic citizenship is creating a new class of global citizens who have no allegiance to any country. So what do they have allegiance to? Don't know, but we'll see. And so there's a whole industry around providing consulting for individuals who are looking for passports. I don't have the number with me, but I was shocked to see the number of US citizens last year that gave up their citizenship. It's not only philosophical, it's very symbolic to give up your citizenship. And it wasn't just tax reasons, right? Although that's a primary driver. I'm just curious. Your clients are asking about kind of the whole economic, or the whole citizenship and different alternatives. Just a couple. More and more will, I think. And what about wealth transfer? So this is a report that Wealth-X did with NFP. We're saying there's going to be about $16 trillion transferred over the next 30 years. A significant amount. I just thought I'd put this in here since Neiman Marcus is based in Dallas. Neiman Marcus used our data in their prospectus for their IPO to map their retail locations against the clusters of where the wealthy are, to tell Wall Street that they were well positioned to capture the growth and the wealth of spending and what they're going to spend. It was just an interesting. So what about the markets? Let me get into some data. Let's size the market a little bit. So how big is I'm gonna give you some benchmarks that'll help you understand it, because if I just throw the data out, I feel like often people don't really get it. So the US economy, the US GDP, is $16 trillion, just to give you a sense, right? And this is the Daytona NASCAR Stadium. It holds about 235,000 seats. So think about a NASCAR stadium. So in your mind, think about the US GDP and think about a NASCAR stadium of people, and that's the global population, around the global population of the ultra affluent. So there's about 212,000 individuals who have a net worth. Ultra high worth would find is 30 million net worth and up. And if you add everything together, it's about 30 trillion. So let me summarize it this way. Imagine a NASCAR stadium of people with twice the GDP of the US. What's your reaction? Do you think that's a big number? Did you think it would be more people? Did you think it would be less people? You need more coffee? Thanks, Dale. That really helps. but amazing. So what does that mean, though, in terms of, so what about the average? So based on our data, the average is 60 years old, 141 million, 35 million in the bank, and they got two kids. Right? That's the average profile. But this is the significant part. So, and this is the other thing. This population that we're talking about is not the 1%. It's not the 0.1%. It's not even the 0.01%. It's the 0.004% of the population, right? I always thought it would be funny if some Wall Street kind of protesters got hold of our data and they had like 0.004%. Anyway, that's what I did. But people would be like, what? Because the 1%, frankly, is anyway. But so this 0.004% of the population is responsible for 13% of all the global wealth, though. So again, well, how big is that? Oh, think the NASCAR stadium. NASCAR stadium of people, 13% of all global adult wealth, 37% of all privately managed assets, one out of every $5 spent on luxury, excluding residential real estate, is at NASCAR stadium. And then almost 20% that is philanthropic, non-corporate philanthropic. It's the most concentrated consumer segment, except of course for billionaires, right? So it was very concentrated. Here's how the map kind of lays out globally. If you add in Canada and the US, you've got about 75,000 representing about 10.3. And then you've got Europe. You guys can see it. I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but that's kind of how it's distributed. What about by country? This is fascinating. There was a great article in the New York Times this week about Germany and how the wealth is just amassing. The German citizens save so much. They have it in their, because the U.S. is going to try to put pressure on them to start doing more domestic consumer spending. But Germany is number two in the world, right? Now, but in relative terms, Germany's at around 20 and the U.S. is around 70. So in relative terms, the U.S. is significantly more, right? And then look at China. So China is growing unbelievably fast. It's a rocket ship. And the wealth is growing fast. It's mostly first generation wealth. There's no estate plan, and there is estate planning, but it is almost first generation, right? So, but still, in relative terms, 11,000 compared to 70. Now you know why the luxury brands are saying, hey, we probably need to get back to Houston and Chicago. What about by city? No surprise, New York's number one. London's after that, Tokyo, San Francisco, Los Angeles. But look at number nine. People are always, especially when I do this to an audience that's global. Number nine, Chicago. If you look at the data. And oftentimes, there's my friend who used to start Elite Traveler, the Jet magazine, and loves data. He always hammers the fact that most people are opening offices all over the world and they have no idea what the match is for the data. I mean, here's the US by state, and then we just do the top city. So here we go. So we got New York. So if you look on the right, the bold ones are the US rank. The left is the world rank. But New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Chicago, Washington, D.C., and there you guys are. Houston's number six. Right above Dallas.
The way it should be.
And then Atlanta bumps down way about half of that, right? So big gap between Atlanta and Dallas. And there's Charlotte there at the end. We made it. We made the cut. So we got 440 folks there. One of the other trends we see is what we call the virtual family office, right? What is it? If you look on a P990, right, and you look at a family foundation, you look, it oftentimes it'll show you, this doesn't show it, but I'll give you the example. It shows you who's on the board. And typically, here's what we see. You've got a probably held business, They built it. There's a CFO or COO, right? And that person basically becomes the family office. He becomes the person that starts looking at deals. He becomes the person that starts prodding them, saying, we need to get an estate plan in place, right? And I've always said, if you look at the board of a private foundation and it's all family members and there's one person on that board that's not a family member, that guy's a trusted advisor, right? So what about the psychographics of this group? I'll play around a little bit more fun here. So who knows, you know, you guys know the advertising for Patek Philippe, right? Patek Philippe is not about, we're absolutely the most luxurious watch in the world, although they are, or they say that. So anyone know what their number one kind of advertising theme is? For your son, that's right. You never buy a Patek Philippe watch for yourself. It's always the next generation, right? So the person that buys this watch is very different than the person that buys this watch, Panerai. Anyone know why Panerai is, I always laugh because I know they're executives. I'm always like, I don't get it, but people love Panerai. Panerai's story is their origins are in the Italian Navy. So they always talk about the craftsmanship of the Italian Navy, and I'm like, I know David, right? I'm like, I don't know if I'd be betting on the Italian Navy. But if you talk to someone who has a Panerai, the first thing they say is, did you know it came from the Italian Navy? And I'm like, I still don't know why we're selling that. I don't, you know, but people love it, right? So there's a certain kind of person that buys this kind of watch, right? And then there's the MBNF, which is Maximilian, who's a friend of mine. He lives in Dubai. He's the founder, and he is an artist. They make about 20 of these a year. There's a very particular kind of person that buys this watch. You guys are laughing. You don't. Yeah, it looks like the cockpit of an airplane, right? It's actually very, very light though. It's about, I think it's 400,000, right? So it's a bit more than most of the other watches. But he certainly doesn't do bespoke watches. You can try to ask him, but he won't. He's very much an artist. So. My point is, I think luxury is fascinating because it's a window into who someone is. And everybody has, you may say, well, my clients don't care about luxury. That's right, they probably don't. A lot of them don't. But they have something they care about. They have something that they collect that gives a window into who they are, whether it's stamps or basketball cards or whatever it is, right? Because when you get wealth, it helps you. It finds its way to something that was in your heart that you couldn't do before. It amplifies it. I call wealth an amplifier, right? So I thought it'd be interesting just to think about at a high level, how do luxury brands, I think it's a good lesson, how do they try to reach this group? How do they try to engage this audience? If you're, you know, so today, the number one way they try to do it is through print advertising. It's not often, you can't do it through digital because the data hasn't been part of the ecosystem yet. But so I thought it'd be interesting. So you may know Groff Diamond, right? So Groff Diamond, this is probably $400,000, $500,000 they're promoting. This, by the way, is called the Jewel Box. It's a rotation of luxury brands every day on the front cover of the New York Times. So tomorrow it'll be Tiffany and then it'll be Harry Winston. So, and they pay an enormous amount of money for this. But I thought it was just unbelievably ironic to see this, and then up here you've got people who are homeless now carrying their last living possessions in a bag on their back. Now, did Groff want that? No, of course not. That's the last thing they frankly wanted, was the juxtaposition of those two content. There's been a massive proliferation of different jet services, right? But I thought I couldn't help putting this one in the presentation because, so here's ExoJet, which by the way, I know the executives there, and they're a great company. They say, we're just getting started, right? And then if you look over here, you're like, oh, what are we just getting started on? Oh, we're just getting started on Zika spreading while I'm traveling. And then we're just getting started on a Somali jet has a bomb on it. So we're gonna take you there. We're gonna take you all, we're gonna take you everywhere, right? I thought, how ironic. I mean, I wonder if they ever even actually saw, I should show this, I should email this to them, right? But great irony. But this is how inefficient the market is for engaging this audience. This is today. This isn't like 10 years ago. This is like, you know, last year or this year. But when I was boiling it down, I was thinking about the most fundamental question around these, right? And how does, you know, if you think about it this way, how does an ultra high net worth individual, how do they gauge you? How do they assess you? Right? Well, there's only a few ways, frankly, right? One is you are introduced by somebody they trust. And this obviously is the most common way. And basically what you're doing is you're riding off that other person's social capital that they built over a decade or whatever it is with someone. And they say, listen, Jim, you really should meet Bob. Jim's like, I don't have time. He's like, I'm telling you, you gotta meet with him. He says, fine, I'll meet with him. So now he's riding off of the social capital of the other relationship, right? And I would say by and far that is the most fundamental philosophical core principle that I believe drives the best practices, understanding that market, and everything else comes from. If you realize the reality of that, right? What's the next thing? Common passions, hobbies, or interests, right? We were talking about last night, David Robinson was talking about Staubach, right? Both, what do they have in common? The Navy, right? It's finding those things in your past and history that you've done, right? Or, you know, I was a swimmer. If I meet another swimmer, we both know we spent 3 hours looking at the bottom of a pool for a large part of our life, right? Every day, right? And you know they got up at 6 a.m. You know, there's things you know automatically that help you triangulate, right? And then there's chemistry. Sometimes you meet someone and you hit it off. You hit it off. This is just my example. On LinkedIn is a perfect example, right? When someone tries to connect with me, the first thing I, what's the first thing you do when somebody tries to connect with you that you don't recognize? Who's your mutual contact? Because you know what it does? It gives you context. If it's from my church in New York, if they're connected to my pastor, I'm like, okay, maybe he has bad judgment sometimes, but I'll go ahead. I'm kidding. Or if it's my wife's boss, David Kidder, who wrote the Startup Playbook and is one of the top entrepreneurs, if he knows him, I'm like, you know, or if it's Peter Thiel, right? Although these days, maybe not. Anyway, this is Casey Crawford, by the way. He's an NFL football player who started a company called Movement Mortgage down in Charlotte that's killing it. And they are incredible in their core values they have in their building. Anyway, but he was a new friend I met recently, and so we were kind of figuring out, you know. And I'm just going to skip. I've got 10 minutes, so I'm going to skip to kind of what I think the future is holding, and then I'm going to open up for questions. So by the way, this report just came out from Knight Frank, which is London-based, and their wealth report is amazing, so I highly recommend downloading it. And I just actually, they asked me to write something recently, and I just wrote a section on blockchain and family offices for them. And he just emailed me yesterday and said it's now, the blockchain implications are now one of the biggest things they have in all the presentations now presenting when they talk about real estate and the assets. So, you guys may or may not have seen this. This was just announced a week ago. Northern Trust now for administration on private equity is gonna use artificial intelligence and blockchain. But sorry, do you guys know what blockchain is? Who knows what blockchain is? Okay, wow, okay. So who knows what Bitcoin is? Everybody, okay. So blockchain is the foundation or infrastructure that Bitcoin is built on top of. It is what people now are recognizing is one of the most significant trends that will happen in terms of impacting the way we do everything. It's a distributed ledger, basically, is the most easiest way to think about it. But it will fundamentally alter anything we do that has transactions, contracts, everything. So this Northern Trust is, I think, way out. Those guys are way out ahead with IBM on think about fund administration and the data, right? So blockchain, this is fascinating amount. It doesn't provide more trust. It actually eliminates the need for trust because when you do a financial transaction, you have to validate that the person you're sending the money to, the person, all these things have to happen. With blockchain, it happens almost instantaneous. But I think, I'm telling you now, it's a fascinating philosophical question. By eliminating the need for trust, and you eliminate the friction and the cost, but the question is, well, what will happen with the need to have trust, right? So Blockchain Revolution is one of the books that's come out recently. He says, in our view, companies that conduct some or all of their transactions on the blockchain will enjoy a trust bump in share price. So in other words, he's predicting that down the road, companies that have blockchain as part of their infrastructure will have that kind of bump in the share price. Data is the new asset class. And I, when I consult or talk to companies, I tell them this all the time. You have to start thinking about yourself as a data company. One that may trump previous asset classes. Another is the undermining of our traditional concepts of privacy and the autonomy of the individual. Right? So who has been dealing with common reporting standards for your clients yet? Okay. So this is coming. CRS, common reporting standards, and this form of data, the automatic exchange of information, is going to make it a uniform data vocabulary. And no one's talking about the intersection of this with blockchain, but I'm telling you that's the future. Because you have to have transparency, and you have to have the ability to speak with different government entities, for example, sharing. And blockchain allows you to control what's distributed. You can build what's called a handshake technology that allows you to only share what you want to share, right? So some of the other things happening, this is part of my portfolio that I'm building. Premex is a company that we just launched a couple, I'd say 2 months ago. Knock on wood, we're getting a term sheet this week. So excited about that. And it basically is taking everything I've learned about the data world and wealth and applying it to the digital world in the ad tech ecosystem. Because today you can't, if you're a luxury brand, you have no tools to really accurately target someone that's above. Today you can only target someone who has a household income of 200,000. I know it's hard to believe, it's a blind spot, it's incredible. But, and then I thought I'd give you guys a glimpse at LifeChain. So LifeChain is a blockchain infrastructure that's powering a new multifamily office called Zvesta. But the idea is we believe that we can redefine the way that families interact and relate and report on capital in their life. So not just the financial capital, because everyone's already doing that. But what about philanthropic capital? What about a consolidated performance report that has your philanthropic capital returns, your financial capital, your private operating business, and then your human capital, your kids? How are they doing? Who are they connecting with? And not only that, from a risk perspective. And then what about your social capital? What do I have? How am I doing? And then, but how do I compare? Am I giving more or less as a percentage of my net worth than someone else? Today, it's all about how much did you give. It should be about the parable of what's called the widow's mite, where the Pharisees gave more, but she gave a mite. And the parable was she gave everything she had, right? It should be about the percentage, right? And then even bringing in more analytics and data, for example, around life insurance as an asset class. It should be integrated. It's one of the most important tools that you guys use, especially premium financing, right? So that's kind of my view of the future. This is my, I have several portfolio companies, so I have 7 email addresses, but this one's the easiest one to get hold of me. So my Gmail address, davidsfriedman@gmail.com. And let me, And for a first time in my entire life, I have 2 minutes left for questions. This is like incredible. Right? Yes?
What companies did you say benefiting
from
this
conversion to
CRS?
I mean, listen, I think the big accounting firms are gonna get lots of, they're already writing about blockchain and how it's gonna change everything. The truth is no one's done anything. People are launching betas and prototypes. I think the big accounting firms are going to make a lot. I think there'll be boutique players that build the infrastructure and that then build an ecosystem into various infrastructures. Like, let's just take life insurance, for example. Imagine a smart contract where data is pulled in, it's continually reading on the public newspapers, and the money is in the blockchain, it gets released automatically. There is no administration fee from the carrier. you reduce all that friction. There's a tremendous amount of friction in the system, or milestone-based philanthropic giving. I talked to this about, well, my close friend Scott Harrison runs a charity called Charity Water, which Michael Birch was one of the biggest donors, by the way. And I was saying, imagine he has Google Analytics on his wells that reports the data. Imagine if you're a philanthropic investor and you say, here's the milestone, put it in the blockchain, it pulls in the data, it releases the money automatically. Philanthropic, milestone-based philanthropic giving. Now you gotta call them, not you gotta look, it's about reducing all of this friction. But I think the big accounting firms are gonna, they know, they're already doing the thought leadership around it. They still don't really, no one's actually put, for example, we're hoping to be the first to put a life insurance policy in the blockchain as a smart contract. Because imagine the ability, because the other thing about blockchain is it's unhackable. You can't, the way it's built, you can't just get into it and change it. It's built on a whole chain. So to change the whole thing, you have to change the whole chain. So imagine disputes over estates or policies or any of those things. I'm telling you, that stuff's gonna get, that will go away. In a good way, I think. Especially among heirs, right? I think it also will force transparency among families. Because the kids are gonna have to get access. They don't have to get access to it, but you're gonna wanna provide that transparency. I think fundamentally it's gonna change all those areas. I mean, the financial services side is the easiest one. People are already implementing that. Where, you guys know from a settling perspective, when you buy an equity or whatnot, there's all this friction that happens. It takes a day to settle it and whatnot. That's all gonna go away in blockchain. The reason it's that way is because they have to validate who the parties are. Anything that requires that type of validation. Yeah, so. One more question?
How did WealthX go about gathering the information to identify the ultra wealthy? Because here in the South, there's a big issue with privacy. There are a lot of very wealthy people that are very private that you would not know are ultra wealthy.
That's right, yeah. I should have told you guys, I always say about WealthX, right, which, by the way, again, I'm no longer formally involved. I am a minority shareholder. But I used to always say, listen, if you walked into a WealthX office, you will never find binoculars or muddy boots, right? Is Roderick here? Where's Roderick? Oh, he's on my panel. He has binoculars and muddy boots. But he runs, he has all MI6, MI5, CIA guys, right? We didn't do that. So it was all public data, but our team was trained to look for signals. They would look for an interview with a high school paper where someone donated $5,000. That was a trigger. And then from there we would say, man, the article would say, if it wasn't for his wrestling coach, he would. It's funny, we had a great story. One of my sales guys went in and was sitting down with a guy to talk about WealthX data, and they were looking through a dossier, and the story was about this guy, how he was not a very good wrestler. Freshman year didn't do so well. Sophomore year, the coach came in, really worked with him, and by junior year, he was state champ. And then afterwards, my sales guy at that time said, and then the guy looked at him and said, yeah, he was really bad. But when I worked with him my sophomore year, he did turn around. It was him, it was the guy. Anyway, it was funny. But it was a great story, right, of how, so all public, but they just know where to look. I mean, we used to have awards for finding hidden billionaires like in Eastern Europe, right? That was like your weekly bonus if you found, if you were one of our researchers, right? But here's the key, and I'll be done. Most of this wealth is probably held in a family-owned business. It's why no data set was built around this before, because finding that company, and more importantly, valuing a popcorn, company in Iowa, right? The Weaver Popcorn, I think it is. They're the third largest producer of popcorn in the world. Valuing that company is very, very challenging. Significant amount of time and effort, which is why the data set became so valuable. So, does that answer your question? Okay. All right. One last question?
No.
Hey, at least you didn't have to pull me off the stage.
Thank you, David.